Have you given any thought to contributing to The Melt? It's easy to do. Just click the Patreon link in the episode notes, and for as little as $3 a month, you can get access to bonus episodes, early access to regular episodes, and you can also participate in monthly Zoom meetups. It helps to keep the magic happening here at The Melt. So I encourage you to karmically entangle yourself with The Melt today by subscribing monthly for less than the price of a container of goatee wax, or a prosthetic pinky, or a half stick of DMT butter, or an inflatable casket, or the shrunken head of an Atlantean supermodel, or a woolly mammoth's merkin, or a crystalline replica of Baba Yaga's hut, or a capsule of Sasquatch dander.
This is Hunter Muse.
And this is Chris Snipes, and you are listening
to The Melt.
More and more, it seems that those with the most Babylon hokey pokey tokens, media conglomerates, and seemingly our attention are focused on constructing the counterfeit to end all counterfeits. They actually have the arrogance to think that they can permanently separate you from the natural world. On top of that, they think that their counterfeit version of reality is better. After trying to confuse us that we are not our bodies with ever-pervasive gender confusion ideology, pitting us against each other with identity politics, and utilizing the chuckle-headed theatrics of politrics to continuously have us at each other's throats, somehow thinking that the two-party tentacles aren't leading back to the same soulless octopus, they are banking on that we will be caught between acute confusion as to who and what, not to mention where, we are, and appropriately anesthetized by our bread and circuses so that we don't realize the monumental hoodwink that is taking place. It's like in Indiana Jones and the Raiders of the Lost Ark when he's stealing the golden idol and he tries to switch it for a bag of sand that weighs the same as to not set off the booby traps. The hoodwink is that you are a random accident that arose out of primordial ooze within a random set of circumstances that just happen to be convenient for such. We only live once, and all that we need give credence to are things that can be measured and repeated. First-hand experience isn't to be trusted, and we should leave the thinking and speculating to the experts. We need to elect leaders to be our nannies because we are just shiftless heathens who can't be trusted to act like big boys and girls. Well, I call total bullshit on all of the above. This is a disempowerment game, and they are counting on the fact that you think that you have no self-worth, have adopted apathy as your mindset, and think that you couldn't possibly have anything to offer in a world that seems to be spinning right along with or without you. The truth is that there would be a different reality confluence without your presence that would likely set off a chain reaction of effects that would change or shift your family and community on out to the universe. Your thoughts and actions count more than you can imagine, and we are capable of so much more than we are led to believe. Today's guest, Crow777, and the work that he and Jason Lindgren do on his podcast might be just the medicine that you need to lift the veil from your eyes and come into your own as an autonomous, self-governing, living man or woman. We spoke with him on the auspicious date of 9/11, and I begin the conversation by asking Crow what it is about the numbers 9 and 11 that we should be paying attention to.
Well, this is a catch-22. A very wise friend and mentor to me pointed out that there is no meaning on anything here until we assign meaning to it. And this, in fact, is part of the trap. But while I won't go and claim that I can give you, you know, the values or the direct correlation of what every number means, it's pretty clear that they're being used. And I will say this of 9/11. In a normal world, well, there's a few things. First of all, zero doesn't exist in nature. And yet we use it all the time. And while we use it to say 10, it has no specific meaning. It's a placeholder, right? It tells you that you're going up. But the way that the modern world is treating zero is as if it had reality in nature. So when we look at a normal counting cycle, a normal person, an average person, would count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. In essence, what they have attempted to employ is a broken endless loop, because you start out your day normal. You say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And then all of a sudden you skip 10, you jump to 11, 1 and 1 is 2, you loop back on a new cycle, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 11, 2, 3, you know, you see it's like a broken endless loop idea.
Yeah.
But this number is significant for so many reasons that, I mean, if I actually was planning to come speak about this, I myself would have to go look as an example. It's the first year. It's the first day of the year in a Coptic calendar. There are so many things about it. In my worldview, I differ a little bit from like the Christian mystics who treat 10 as a completion. I treat 9 as a completion. I treat 10 as perfection, because that 1 is like the creator. If it was gendered, it would be masculine. If it was colored, it would be red. If it was polarityed, it would be positive. And so when we go into looking at these things, what I try to do is I try to value them out in nature, because in nature, there's a flip side, right? If something good happens, something bad could happen. If it's light outside, guess what? It can be dark outside. And as human beings, we really would wish we could snap our fingers and say, well, I always want it to be good and light. But the truth is we learn and we do things quickly when things go south. We learn very quickly, we adjust very quickly, and big things get done on the back of bad things. And I think this is also part of why the so-called controllers put so much controversy into our lives, because they want to steer that thing that gets built on the other side. And so while 9 and 11, on the face of it, they're not bad. And even if you took their basic numerology, on one side, there's a positive note. On the other side, there's a negative note. And I think this is important to remember. And I opened up with a very important, it gets the meaning we assign to it. So to get stuck on it and to... An example of this is going through your life, and every time this happened to me for a long time, every time I looked over a clock, sometimes twice a day, it would say 9/11. And I'm all, what the heck? And then I began to realize this is too big a part of what I'm thinking about. And I jettisoned it. And now it doesn't happen so frequently. I don't assign the meaning. I'm just aware, you know, that it gets used nonstop.
Sure.
It's a marker. It's a poke in your eye. Look what we did on 9/11. Look how we changed the whole world, and everybody's too dim-witted to catch on or do anything about it.
Ironically, the first time I looked at a digital clock this morning, it said 9/11.
That's important, you know, to note that to yourself. I get a lot of messages from other people who say they see 111, you know, on a clock all the time. Uh-huh. And some very intelligent people who impress me greatly say that this has to do with what you're holding, you know, what you're focusing on and what you're holding in your being. And I kind of think it's true. I used to see 9/11 an awful lot. And then when I realized that, I started paying attention. I said, you know, 9/11 does not shape my existence here. I let go of it.
It's like once you enter it into the radar log, then it pops up and it notifies you when it's there, and you have to kind of pay attention to it and make note. It was like that with the number 23 for me for a while. Everywhere I would see that number, I think that came up because of, I don't know, stuff that I was into at the time. But yeah, it's, you know, that isn't the most significant number, but again, it does seem to come up in your podcast and in your worldview a lot. So obviously there must be a there, as you would say.
It's almost like a thumbprint or a signature for, you know, a long time people would holler, oh, there's 33, that evil 33. And there's a reason. You can't take 100% of anything and divide it in three without 33.
Yes.
As the most basic demonstration. And I would also point out that what has come into my sphere of knowing is while there are people out there doing things we don't appreciate, they also know a lot of things that we were not taught. And if you can learn those things, you can employ them, just hopefully not with a dark side like they do, not with a selfish, low vibrational side that we see. And that brings us around to the idea of where we are. In my view, the sun is not the sun we used to have. It's a higher vibration. And all these old brutish systems from lower vibrational times, they have to go away now. And human beings don't like change. I don't like change. Most people don't like change. And it's hard. Well, money is a lower brutish system. All Absolutely. These things are jurisprudence, all these things that don't really have much concern for a living man or a living room. It's my point of view that that's all got to crumble to the dirt. And that includes the low vibrational forces behind them. And I think they're like the Titanic. You know, when that big colossus goes down, anyone in this vicinity is getting sucked down with it. So that's my point of view of where we're going. It's not all gloom and doom, but yeah, you know, it's not going to be easy, I'm sure.
Yeah.
It's not going to be easy.
And, you know, as you said, the numbers in and of themselves don't have an inherent quality about them. But unfortunately now, because of obviously 9/11, what happened on 9/11/2001, that's the thing that sticks in our mind. So I wonder if that is purposeful. So we have we're sort of forced to have a negative connotation of it.
Of course.
Yeah.
And there's proof of that in the familiar timeline. We've all, what was it, 1960 something, they put the emergency dial code on your phone. So when something bad happens, what do you dial? 911. This was all very well thought out. And it's part of why I think it's important to pay attention to numbers. For me, 9 will always be a completion. 10 will always be the idea of perfection. But here's the thing. Now, Crowley, a man who I have no respect for, who was self-centered, who was dark, he made the statement, you know, 11 is the evilest of numbers. And I thought, well, who the hell is he to me? Why? Tell me why 11 is the evil. And then I realized from the Christian mystics, if 10 is perfection, then 11 is the first step away from perfection. So
makes sense.
I guess that's why Crowley wants to call it the evilest of numbers. But the thing is you're in a new octave when you go to 11, right? You're headed towards 20 instead of 10. And that's a full octave higher.
Yeah. And as I was bringing up when we were talking before I actually hit record, and it was brought to my attention by Hunter, there is the 911 days have passed since the COVID was officially announced and the Queen's death, which there's got to be some sort of auspiciousness to that, I would imagine.
Look at the giant brain on Hunter. I'm guessing very few people caught that. And yeah, you're right that, you know, that we're not living in a world of coincidence here, are we?
No, not at all. And numerology also plays out in just in and of itself, regardless of 9/11, in the worldview that you seem to take. Where did that come from? What put numerology and the importance of numbers on your radar?
Maybe it goes back to how I opened. Nothing in this place has meaning that we don't assign to it. In other words, everything we think about and the way we make systems to live here is man-made. And we could use the example, does nature have numbers? Well, I guess you could argue one way or the other, but okay, if you say yes, then why aren't we using base 15? Why are we using base 10? So even the way we count a thing is constructed by human minds. And so with a construction or an invention of a human mind, intention and meaning has automatically been embedded in these things. As an example, is maybe if I was a hermit and I said, you know what, I'm letting go of everything, I'm going to go live on a mountain, would I ever need a number again?
Yeah, exactly. I think
not. I would ask.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, I think as humans, we are taxonomous, and it's one of our necessities or our intentions is to create order out of what could be considered a chaotic environment. And animals don't necessarily do that. They really live on this basis of instinct. And so a flower is not counting its petals, but a human will go and count the petals on a flower.
Perfect. I'm with you 100%. And even if we want to go to the established religions of the part of the world where we live, in Genesis, it says that very thing, right? You're going to be the master of this joint, manage this joint. And by the way, go ahead and name everything in this place. And so what we began to realize is we would like to decipher nature. Look at this perfect system that we can barely comprehend. So we start in with, as you say, the taxonomy. From now on, we're going to call this purple. And then we're going to work at it. You know, well, why is it purple? What makes this purple? And for that matter, why does it have 12 petals? And that's how we start to get into maybe the idea of alchemy and other things, these natural sciences. But this too, I mean, folks know what happened with men and women. They go off the rails. They leave the natural bounds behind, and they try to exceed or hack what basically I like to say the creator created. If we just stayed within those bounds, I am convinced we could meet magical levels far beyond what technology does for us. But here we are hacking and hacking. You know, we can't make a fish from scratch, but we can sure as hell figure out how to make one breed off season, you know, hacking nature because I want this fish to eat when it's not supposed to be here in nature. That's what we do, kind of. And I think that's part of the systems that have to crumble to the ground now.
Yeah, we think by counting and measuring and weighing nature and quantifying it in all the different ways that we do, that we're going to uncover some secret behind it when there's no need to even do those things. That doesn't get to the heart of the matter.
I agree on the one hand, because I know the sentiment you put behind it. But if things like alchemy or natural science were back where Hunter put us, we have to have words to describe this.
True.
We have to have a way to say, look, I've got a handful of these things. So consider this, though. I forget what I was reading. Apparently, the spiritual view of how we measure things claims that in the way we do it here in the West, with an inch and a furlong and a hand for a horse, there's still the vestige of the natural world in it. Mm-hmm. Now, when you go over to millimeters and centimeters, you've become purely sterile, uncaring, devoid of this randomness that is now trying to bring a surgical precision to that which has none. And so even in the measuring, we can detect, are we close to nature here, or have we departed entirely?
Yeah, I agree. No flower of even of the same kind is going to be the exact same as the other flower. They're all unique in some way or form.
So remarkable. I pray every day and I give thanks and I do this very thing. I'll pick up a couple rocks on the beach and I will recognize that these are absolutely unique in the world. And when I do this, I begin to think in what I hope is a more helpful way. Like I realized the other morning down at the beach, my perspective is unique in all the world. If I put my wife's head right next to mine and we looked at a ship on the horizon, still her angle of approach would be slightly different than mine. Put her 10 feet. And so then I began to realize the complexity and perfection in this natural system. Everything is basically unique if you break it down.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, and what you're talking about is perception. So if I say purple to you, your perception of what that word means could be completely different from my perception. You may see your version of that color and it could be lilac. Mine might be more of a darker version of that. So in communicating, we're really kind of flying blind because we're relying on the fact that somewhere we're meeting in the middle using the same terminology and the same words.
Damn, you're on fire today, Hunter. We did an episode called, I think, The Mysterious World of Color. And what we found these really old texts which talked about color. And it got all the way back to where they were dyeing, because dyeing was such a big, important art, because they knew, if I want to dye this thing this color, it's not that easy, is it? I want it to be exactly what you're saying, but consider how the Japanese went at the problem you just expressed. They would say things, well, it's like a cherry blossom 5 days into its bloom. And that's how they bench. This is the color I'm talking about. And what's crazy is back in these 1800 texts we were drawing from, there was a better focus on what is purple and what does purple mean. And that led me later to go look at the Victorian idea of flowers. Did you know in Victorian times, when people handed flowers, it was loaded with meaning? Mm. Oh, that's a yellow rose you've handed that girl. We know that it means all these things now. We've lost so much of it. And the basic problem you point out, Hunter, is what the heck is purple? My purple is not going to be your purple. And if I go online, it even makes it worse, because this is not reflected color. This is projected color. In nature, it's reflected. So if we go online to try to decide what purple is, we're still missing the mark.
Exactly. I mean, someone could perceive purple with movement, or they could perceive it as an emotion.
Like synesthesia.
It's crazy. The variety that we are faced with and our ability to attach meaning. And, you know, it used to be people would say, well, Crow, what does it matter what people think? And so I used to think about that. I said, yeah, what does it matter what people think? And there's a lot of answers that kind of show you why it's important what you think. But what I realized was, the moment you think, that thought could be measured. So even by a scientific basis, that exists. And then if we go back to the Hermetic principles, I think the first time I bumped into the Hermetic principles, I was too young to get it. It said mentalism. I went, well, what the hell is mentalism? But later, from the Mahabharata or some other place, I remember coming to the claim, mind precedes all reality. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, is that true? And I went about testing it. And now that is a foundational truth of my life. And that comes back to, what the hell is 9/11? If you get what you think hacked by someone else, then in a way you're beginning to project the reality that they're trying to make.
Exactly. Exactly. And speaking of perceptions, I mean, as the realm of quantum theory and physics are concerned, the observer affects what they observe. So that adds a whole other layer to it. That means reality is co-collaborative. So we're all not only seeing stuff, but we're also changing what we see by the way that we see it.
I think it proves a couple of things. Again, it proves that mind precedes all reality is unassailable. And I also think that it begins to demonstrate that we create this place with our minds.
Yes.
And if we loop that back to something like 9/11, what the hell happened there? Well, everyone got hacked, didn't mm-hmm. they?
Yep.
And it's a negative hack. And look what's happened since, you know, all these not so positive things with freedoms and all these terrible ideas have come for the first time in our experience out in the open, as if there's some Goliath that is untouchable. Mm-hmm. And doesn't that all begin with mentalism, the first exactly. Hermetic principle, or the way I like to go at it, mind precedes all reality.
For sure.
Well, that's why the predators had to continue to play that video over and over, like, you know, thousands of times, because the idea was to, you know, brainwash people into believing that what they were seeing was reality.
Right. And look at all the things that preceded that. Basically marketing effort. I mean, let's be honest, we're talking exactly. about a marketing effort, aren't we?
Exactly.
We've done shows on Bernays. If there's another man in the United States that changed openly more about how we live, it would be Edward Bernays, who is the double nephew of, wait for it, Sigmund Freud. Mm-hmm. So this marketer of all time mm-hmm. is coming from the Mind Hack Central, from the halls of power. And so these are basically marketing tools, aren't they? The way that they approach this. But if we grow up, or my version of being grown up, is part of your job is to look at a thing and say, wait a minute, is this right? Is this safe? Will I let my child anywhere near this? Do I want my wife exposed to what I'm looking at? That's what an adult does. And if you're doing that, you're not saying, okay, cool, man, I see what you're doing. Come on, bring it on. You're doing the exact opposite. You're saying, not so fast, pal. What are you doing? Why are you doing it? And how does it affect me and the people I love? That's the adult approach, and it takes the edge off the marketing that Hunter was pointing at. Yeah, you can show me your damn video as many times as you want. Not buying. That's a put up.
Yeah. And that's really the lens that I observe these agendas with. Is the first thing that comes in my mind is like, what is the agenda here? What are they trying to do?
So I do a similar thing. What I logic out is reasonable is source. If it comes from media, to me, it's a lie out of the gate. If it comes out of my television, it's a lie out of the gate. And I may be wrong a very small percentage of the time, but I don't care. I know what television is for. I know what media is for. I know what so-called governments, who are actually corporations, are for. If their lips are moving, it's a lie to my ears the moment it hits them, and you got to prove otherwise. If you want me to ever accept it at any level, you are lying to me right now. Yeah. That's the way I go.
And I think one of the most disappointing things from the PSYOP of the last 2.5 years is finding out how many people are not grownups, and they are just blindly taking on whatever they're supposed to be taking on without any questioning whatsoever.
You know, what you just said reminds me of the attitudes of people hearing the Queen has supposedly passed away. Mm-hmm. And even my first was, well, good riddance, you know, one less in the world to cut. But
that's a reptile.
When I kicked back for a day or two, and people are not going to like to hear what I'm saying, I kind of felt sorry for that low vibrational life that at some point now has to go pay the piper. Because the way that I view what's going on is, I don't want the people I love taking medical procedures that could shorten or end their life. But the fact that they did was their mind preceding their reality and making a choice. And the truth, from my point of view, is I've been sun gazing for longer than I can remember now. That old sun, the way I refer to it, maybe, well, a man who's way spiritually developed beyond me told me that it was the winter solstice of 2012 at the end of one of the Mayan calendars, that he detected this thing happen. And apparently a handful of very advanced people in the world detected it at 4:30 in the morning. That's where I mark the probable change of that sun. Because if you look at a sun in any given year, you're looking at a micro, right? So we go through our winter, we do all these things, we get back to winter. At the low point of the sun stands still for 3 days, then it begins to rise with the programming for that given year. Except that time that I'm referring to, or one close to it, it had programming for a new era within it as well. And so in my sun gazing, it used to be, and by the way, just let me say this, people don't go out and stare at the sun if you don't know what you're doing. Yeah, exactly. You don't give a baby a jalapeno. You can get blinded. So I learned to do it, and I learned second by second. I literally learned 2 seconds, next day, 4 seconds. And there's a certain time of the day you do it so you don't get full on UV. Back then, I always remember the sun was a little yellowy, or, you know, not pure white. But when I felt on my skin that, hey, man, I might be getting a sunburn, it was already too late. I'd already been burned a little bit by the time I detected it. And so when I sun gazed, immediately when I was done, even if I'd only done 30 seconds, I had to close my eyes, cover my eyes, and wait for that bright dot to get off so that I could see the world. Now, what happens when I do it? I can look at the sun midday with my naked eyes, and that dot normalizes much more quickly. And it is such a pure, penetrating, direct white light. And the other thing is, I'm often out now and I think, boy, that sun feels direct, but I'm not getting burned. It used to be when I felt it, I knew I'd already been burned a little. Yeah, now I feel it and I'm able to go. But what I really noticed is it's a higher vibration. And the sky clock is the arbiter of our existence, not the prison keeper. Don't get me wrong. All these possibilities can happen, and they probably will if you're unaware. But a human being is special. If we get up to a level, we don't just jump in the river anymore and let the river take us where it will. We make a canoe And we navigate now on the river. And in some cases, we can even deduce, hey, ma'am, there's like a problem up the river from me that I can't see yet, but I know it's there. So these are the important things. Now, that was a long-winded way of saying we're in a higher vibration time. And so many people are convinced that we're going down the tube. Truth is, I can't tell you. Are we doing this crap for 100 years? I don't know. I don't know how long we're doing this crap. But what I do know is these low brutish, low vibration systems, they're done. Mm-hmm. And all the people who did it. And that begins to ask the question, is that why they're chemtrailing? Are they trying to block that high vibrational light? Sure. Why are they building bases underground? Are they like the Morlocks? They know there's going to come a time they got to get the hell out of the sun to exist. Exactly. I don't know. But what I know is we're headed for higher vibrations, and these brutish ways that we've lived our whole life, that's got to come to an end now.
I also notice that they do a lot of spraying around the full moon. So there's a lot of times where, you know, I would want to go and gaze at the moon, and suddenly it's cloudy and overcast and the moon is not available to view. So I wonder, and especially around the time of the Queen's death, I wonder, you know, is there something going on in the sky that they're trying to block us from seeing?
I have accepted with all of my heart that the arbiter of this existence and the only measure of this fake thing we call time, because let's face it, what is time? But it is movement. Without movement, we don't have time. Mm-hmm. And so the sky clock is the arbiter of every energy as this thing we call time rolls by. Here's what I noticed, Hunter. When I was at the end of the 90s and the early 2000s, trying to tell everyone they were spraying our sky, mm-hmm. I noticed that at night they were doing it over the ecliptic or the path of the sun, planets, so-called planets and moon. Mm-hmm. So I'm with you 100%. Why are they doing it over the ecliptic? Clearly, that's got to be to block light and energies. Why else would they care to spray that specific thing? But here's a crazy thing. I went out some months ago and I went down to the beach to pray and meditate. And I thank the Creator for giving me the divine spark of life, for granting me free will, and for making me beneficiary of this creation. And all at once, I realized I've never claimed these rights. So to the Creator, I claimed those rights on the spot. As I was doing it, they were spraying above my head. So in the same breath that I thanked and claimed those rights granted me by the Creator, I demanded that anyone who infringed on my God-given rights cease and desist. It was like 2 or 3 months, and I never saw them spray the ecliptic again. And I thought, oh my God, wow. Can this be? And I thought, come on, man, could it be so simple? And then I started thinking, maybe it is that simple. But then 2 weeks ago, I saw one spray over the ecliptic. I went down to the beach. I prayed. I thanked the Creator for all the things He had granted me. And I demanded that those who infringe on my God-given rights knock it off. But since that time, I've seen a couple times they're spraying over the ecliptic, not like they used to. So then I began thinking, what if 1,000 people did what I did at the same time? Because the mind precedes all. And I've been thinking about trying to coordinate this on one of the episodes that I do. We'll pick a day and try to say at New York time noon, we'll all go out, claim our rights, thank the Creator, and demand that those who infringe on these rights and just see. Because I was stunned to see that for a long period of time, they didn't spray the ecliptic, which they were doing all the time. But let's face it, I'm like a baby in diapers, man. How could I be wondering such things that I should have known since I was a teenager, you know?
You've had a lot of work, a lot of things working against that. Like everything. All, yeah, for sure. Which leads me to the fact that all the info that you're gathering, all the airtime that you're giving it on the podcast, there definitely seems to be a plot arc there. Like you're moving very much towards something. How would you describe sort of what you're trying to embody?
There is a plot arc. And part of it was if I came out, you know, I've been at this nearly 10 years now, I think. But by the time the podcast came to be, if I said the things that I thought were correct, so many people just weren't ready to hear those words. So then it became, well, maybe if I'm clever enough to figure out the right words and string them together in the right way. And then what I realized is the marketing tactics used against us, they work. The first time they show you a shocking thing, you are shocked. By the time you've seen it 100 times, you're not shocked anymore. And by the time they do it in real life, you almost accept it.
Yeah.
So the plot arc is driven by this idea, where I am trying to go, where I intend to go while I'm doing this, is I pray that I'm teaching compassion, respect for all living things, and to hold the creation on high and protect it above all other things, and know that it is the measuring rod for everything you will ever encounter. There's the basic three-sided premise for where I am going, but you have to incrementally show why this shocking thing you're going to say has any value. You can't just come out and yell it off the mountaintop, because people are, this dude's nutbag, man. He's a bag of nuts. So you show incrementally, look, did you know this was correct? Look, by the way, you know, people yelled at me for saying chemtrails. They just admitted it openly. So now that's off the table. Here it is. There's an article that says, yes, we're doing this. Mm-hmm. And you incrementally get there. And I'm happy to say that when I was on YouTube, I had a demographic audience from 18 all the way up to 70 something. When I quit doing the videos because of the censorship, my demographic got older. I just now have met 25-year-olds that are ready to listen to what we're saying. And to me, that's a big deal, because those 25-year-olds, guess what? They're grabbing the reins at some point when I'm probably no longer here.
Well, one thing I really respect about you and I like about your show is that you don't present information as fear porn. So it's not like you're getting off on talking about these things. It's very direct and very to the point. And I think that's, your delivery has so much to do with people's ability to assimilate the information. I think it's really important, because there are people who really get embedded in that low frequency energy and really like it, and they
perpetuate it.
Exactly. And they feed off of it. So one thing that I've perceived about your show is that you are offering solutions. It's not just based on, let's stay in this low frequency with these low vibration people. Like, how do we get out of it? So I think that's something that's very powerful.
This has to do with the three-sided idea that is under the arc of what I do. And I remember some years ago, I got bit by a mosquito, and I thought to myself, what in the hell good does a mosquito even have in our world? They just suck our blood. They don't do anything good. And I realized, because of that mosquito, that the Creator put everything here, and everything has a purpose. And if you blow that out to a higher level, who the hell am I to take umbrage with a person's spiritual path, or who am I to judge? And so that's the compassion part. I'm not the judge of anything. And so what I did is I said, where we've come from is unacceptable. Where I'd like to go is somewhere much better. And since the Creator put every kind of person here, I will try to speak to every kind of person. That's how we got the word sky clock. I was trying to point out how important the luminaries are. And if I said astronomy, all the astrologers left the room. If I said astrologer, all the astronomers. So I just made up a new word. And now they talk to some degree.
Yeah. And I think that one of the main aspects that I like about your work too, is it all references back, and it seems so obvious when you put it in words, but it all references back to the natural world. And that's an unavoidable reference point, really. I don't know how anybody could have lost track of that, but obviously in our tech-soaked, steeped age that we live in, you realize once you start looking at things that way, how everything is trying to be between you and nature. And that's like the key, that's one of the key obstacles right there, I believe. If you lose track of that, you've really lost the plot.
Has anyone ever bothered to read any of the Bible or the book of Genesis? That's a pretty popular book in this world. And in Genesis, it basically opens with, we got kicked out of the garden.
Yeah. Yeah.
there it is right there. And since that's supposedly living text, each person will draw what they need to draw from it. But this is the measure and being of everything. It has given us everything we know. Sorry.
That's okay.
Fortune's calling me. It has provided everything we have ever needed. And it became a key point of my meditation and prayer because at some point back, I don't know when, I realized not only is it the measure of everything, not only is there no lie in nature, it has provided every single thing we will ever need. And all that we've done is tried to hack that last truth.
Yeah.
And it's a road that can't go any further. Sorry, guys.
That's okay. What was I going to say from there? You had a concept that you brought up in a podcast quite a while back was the concept of being drugged to the crossroads, which I really dug. Would you explain what that means and what the significance of it is in our reality?
You know, I made up what I consider a law for myself. And then I had another law for myself, and I was working on the crossroad to become the third law, but I couldn't get to that point where it goes ding, 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 ding. You're right here. You can run. You can call this a law. I can't get there, or I haven't got there. The first law was simple because I said anything that truly exists in the world and it can be filmed in HD, it will be. And so when you logically, but anyhow, to get to the crossroads, it was so integral when I believe it was. I realized it all at once when we took apart Robert Johnson, the supposed, you know, king of all rock and roll,
yes.
Sold his soul at the crossroads. But what I realized was this marketing that they do, it drags you to the crossroad every single time it hits your ear. It doesn't matter what's been done. You have to make a decision. When you come to the crossroads, you can go forward, you can turn right, you can turn left, you can go back the way you came, or if you want to include the fifth element, you can sit on your butt there till you die. Probably not the best option. And so what I realized is every piece of new information forces you to the crossroad. And what I further realized is they hacked this natural truth because they know people won't take the time to deal with new information.
Sure.
They'll just assimilate it, go with it, maybe even turn the direction they're told to turn. And so the crossroad became the basis of my comprehension of what it means to live in this world. And I proved it true by walking to my front door. I walked to my front door and I realized I could go any direction I want right now. There's the free will the creator gave me, but there's the crossroad at the same time. So what it comes down to, and I wish I could figure out a way to word it, is every new piece of information forces your mind to the crossroad. And if you do nothing, that is a choice too. And someone else will think for you.
So that Robert Johnson goes back quite a ways. We usually, when we think of social engineering having a presence in art and music, we usually think of like Lady Gaga or, you know, more recent pop artists and stuff like that. How far back do you think? I mean, do you think that all art and music are derivative of social engineering, or after a certain point? Or
Yeah, unfortunately. I mean, it may not be 1,000% true in our world, but the main bulk of it is controlled by the same corporations. And by the way, Lady Gaga stands on the shoulders of Robert Johnson, but I've got a sad truth. Robert Johnson never existed as a man. He's a construct. Mm. And that crossroad that he took you to is in the sign, the mental sign of Mercury. The devil horns are in the Mercury sign that he supposedly, it's a mind hack. Go look at all the numbers, you know, born on 9/11 or died on 9/11. You know, he did so many. The 9/11 is just riddling his entire storyline. But Jason, who's an audio engineer, put his ear to it. And he said, you know, this sounds like it's not at the right speed. And he modified the speed of the playback on an old Robert Johnson. And all of a sudden it sounded legit.
Interesting.
And while we can't prove these things, I can prove, and we did an episode on it, Robert Johnson never existed as a living man. If he did exist as a living man, everything else you know about him is a mercurial construct to set the stage for rock and roll, which will be involved in lowering your mind, pushing drugs, breaking the family unit, getting kids to do the wrong thing, and they knew it when they started it. It's the same as the first. Did you know that the first drama ever broadcast on television was the Queen's something? It was called broadcast on 9/11 from a Lord's Manor. They knew from the get-go that they had a tiger by the tail and they were going to use it. And they did. And the entire genre of rock and roll, which is everything now, rap is even a lower version.
Oh, yeah.
We got pummeled with rock and roll. Rap is just rock and roll on steroids. And by the way, what we call music doesn't even need a melody or a harmony anymore. Mm. Maybe it should be called poetry to a beat. But the effect is what happened to me, loving rock and roll, is multiplied many times now through that form of so-called music or any other that came from the Western culture.
Maybe we could call it abusic.
It is. But the sad point is we're self-abusing.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Yeah. Unfortunately, if you hear somebody driving by with loud music on, it seems to be the louder, the lower the density is. Unfortunately, nobody's cranking classical music and driving by.
Well, there's a funny correlation you just made there, right? Bass is the big thing. The yes. low vibration is the big thing. You know, people don't even own tweeters anymore. When I was a kid, everyone had a tweeter. Now nobody has a tweeter. So what are we talking about here, boys and girls? That's the difference between low vibration and high vibration.
Go ahead.
Put it this way. If your sunlight was subject to what your music did, you would not appreciate the light you were standing in.
Yes. Speaking of steroids, that's kind of what the subwoofer has taken on. That's become the biggest part of the sound system is the subwoofer, which is generating the low density, the low frequency.
How low can you go, exactly. right? That's the game. Can we dig a hole in the basement and go lower than this? I think we'll try.
Yes. So do you think that goes back to the classical composers? Do you think that
No.
was? Okay.
No. And as a matter of fact, I did not too long ago, I took it apart to demonstrate, and I brought with me what the creator granted me as beneficiary of this creation. I brought the truth that resides in nature to show what are the parts of an orchestra. Well, you've got woodwind, you've got brass, you've got strings, all making real vibration, all correlatable to the natural world. Mm-hmm. But when you get into the complexity of it, the higher minded complexity of what just basically what I'll call orchestra music was, I mean, at some points they had more than 120 people all being conducted, and they were tuned in 4-3-2. That's a thing it's coming back a little bit, but we all know in the 30s, Rockefeller and some Nazi of some sort made three runs at retuning orchestral middle A became 440. It's an unhelpful frequency. And you can prove it by the cymatics. I had all these piano, when I said that and did the show, all these piano tuners came and told me I didn't know, my you-know-what from my you-know-what. And I said, sorry, Charlie, here's the cymatics. Here's 440 on a cymatic plate. There's no definition. There's no complexity. And it's a muddy blur. Here's 432. Complexity, definition. There it is. On the face of it, you can see that there is a difference. And so if you want to get a higher-minded bump from the music you listen to, go back to the old composers. If you're a Mozart lover, then love Mozart. If you're a Beethoven, think about people like, who is a Bach. That man was playing four lines of music. Normally, a piano player sees a treble clef and a bass clef. So one hand is playing the bass, the other the treble. Bach is playing four lines. Each of his 2 feet is playing another line.
Yeah.
And the higher-minded nature of music at that level should show you these are complex ideas, and they had to move us away from that. You know what? Right before the simple minded rock of the 50s, I want to hold your hand, or I love you, yeah, 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 or whatever it was. What were we replacing? Big band music, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
All that big band music. So that's where the complexity ended. The day the music died was sometime in the 50s, but it wasn't because Buddy Holly fake died.
So you think there's some redeeming qualities to jazz and big band too?
This is what I say. Okay. I say if you can correlate it to nature, then you can make that call for yourself. Mm-hmm. I accept that classical music is legit in its intention and its delivery and can be measured to prove it against the creation. I can't tell you about jazz or other things.
Just curious on your take.
I would imagine that if I understand jazz, which I do not, that it's maybe unique every time you hear it.
Exactly.
So just on that basis, that's higher minded. You're not being echoed and playing the same bridge and the same chorus. But, do they tune? Are they using distortion chambers? What is the meaning behind the music?
Sure. I like the life. I mean, that's one of the things I like about jazz the most is that the improvisational aspect of it. You need a human being, a living human being there reacting with other living human beings. It's no AI can reproduce jazz.
So what little I know of jazz, I get the sense that it has no chorus and bridge that keep being repeated, and that each time a song is played, it will probably be unique. That's higher minded on the face of it. It means you're creating, which means your mind is creating. And by the way, very few people know with music, you use both sides of your brain. Mm-hmm. When you write the way we do, you use one side of your brain. As a matter of fact, if you go over to Asian characters, they're using both sides of their brain on the symbolic way that they write. So these are things that I think were employed with intention.
It does seem like there's a ramping up of the propaganda right now. And it almost feels like it's a last gasp to hold on to the reality that they've created. How do you see this unfolding?
I guess what I'm willing to say is there's a line that we've got to make it to. I don't know if that line is 10 years away, 3 years away, 100, 200 years away. I don't know. But at that line, we will have entered a world where what is being rebuilt is at a higher vibration, putting living things at the center, living men and women valued above some low-minded banking system as an example. But what we also know is misery loves company. And if these folks know they're going away, then maybe they're just trying to take as many as they can, or maybe they're so deluded that they really do think they're gods of this place. And they think if they try hard enough, they can keep the control. But the train wreck's already happened, I've been saying. We're waiting for the body count. Matter of fact, there is a body count that we're not even aware of already.
It seems like we're slowly being drugged to the idea of a completely simulated world, like the meta bullshit, and uploading our quote-unquote consciousness, which I don't think anything having to do with consciousness can be broken down to binary code, but having us be uploaded to a hard drive somewhere and living on forever, which is such a ridiculous notion. I don't believe anybody even gives it the time of day, but maybe people will do the final waking up when they're not politely leading us anymore, but they're trying to cram us into that cage. And then that's when people go, holy shit, this affects me on a level that I didn't even anticipate.
I think if we get to that point, it'll be a little worse. I think they're going to make the actual world outside so miserable that people are clamoring to get into the Ready Player One idea. Yes. But here's the problem. Anyone who realizes how they got here and all the things they have been granted realizes that in natural science, anything that is within nature where there is no lie can be broken down to a body, a spirit, and a soul. And all digital things fail this test. And by the way, it's ones and zeros. Zeros don't exist in the natural. There is no thing in nature. In nature, there is a thing. There's another thing. There are things.
Yes.
But there is no thing. And so just the quality of what's being employed, this fake pale shadow of reality where they can try to be gods, I guess, you'll make a decision and you'll go, you know, wherever you're going. From my point, it would not be possible for me to go there.
Well, when I perceive Mark Zuckerberg, for example, and you kind of look at his career and where his career has gone, he really started out as a wealthy kid who was extremely socially awkward, who was creating basically a slam book of girls and rating them from the perspective of a young college person. What I think is so interesting is that he took that model and now has tried to absorb as much of humanity and the human experience as he possibly can. It just seems so surreal that someone who is that disconnected from people has now created this version of reality that he wants to jam all of us into.
All right, you've kind of opened up a Pandora's box that is so horrific, and I'll do the best that I can here. Of the damaging things that were done in the modern era, Facebook and social media are right at the top. Maybe the only thing that's going to be as damaging is cell phones. Here's the thing. I saw 10 minutes of some movie that was so ridiculous, I couldn't sit down in the room where everyone was watching. I had to get away, but they had all this data points on people, and everyone wanted to know, it's what I've been saying. They could, if they wanted to, all the millions of data points they've collected on any of us for everything, our medical records, what we've bought, what, you know, library books, what time we leave our house, what time we get, it puts you into a psychological profile. And so you are not only data mined, but the psychological profile around you is data mined. And the specificity is utterly shocking. They can take all the data on any one of us, and they can predict to a 98% certainty what will kill you, where you will be the minute it happens, and your geography and everything else about you. You will never know this. And in this movie, all the people were saying, yeah, I want to know when I'm going to die. One of the people were told, you're going to be killed by a boktung or some word we've never heard. And she asked the guy, what the heck is a boktung? Well, I don't know. Well, they blew up the world. They screwed it up so badly with all their data collection and everything. They go to another world, and there's this beautiful bird in the new world, and she walks up to it and it bites her head off. And the guy looks at the camera and says, ah, now I know what a boktung was. Think of the implications. So they came from a world where there are no boktung, and yet the AI was able to magically work it out. The AI is the biggest hack. And by the way, let me be clear. It's not AI. It does not have a body, a soul, and a spirit. It will never be intelligent. It is an algorithm.
Yeah.
It's how I choose to describe it. But we have machine learning. We figured out how to get a snippet of code to improve by failing. So every day since that has been online, it has been improving what it does with the goal of this. Whoever predicts human behavior the best gets paid the most.
Mm.
And they have a magical time machine because they know what's going to happen before it happens. And that is what algorithms, not living, never living. You can't upload someone's consciousness to a damn hard drive. Yeah. It's laughable, man.
It is.
The creator made a human being. Some dude at Dell made the hard drive, mm-hmm. to be clear about it. But this data collection, it's going to be the downfall. Its power and sweep is beyond. The people who control it are going to end up infighting. You know they will. Your AI is better than my AI, so now we got to fight. What happens when you put six jackals in a room, you know? It's got to be a fight.
Yeah, for sure. And how audacious is it to say that you can simulate consciousness? I mean, it's such a ridiculous concept on so many levels. It just... yeah, it's just fantasizing. And it really tries to, I mean, it's a symptom of material reductionism gone mad, because it still restricts you to the physical world in even a coarser way than you were in your body. It's just preposterous.
If it was possible, it would be the ultimate downgrade and take a long time to get out of. I guess would be the thing to say it, but you know, there's another truth that nature shows us: all created things will see their end.
Indeed.
All of them. So even if this horror show came around for 100, I mean, think about how long the United States was a couple hundred years, man. And now look where we are. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
you exactly. know, they're claiming there was one that was 1,000. There was one that was 2,000. I'm not sure I'm buying, folks, but I've come to comprehend that the best laid men's of, you know, plans of mice and men. So I'm just saying, it all comes to an end.
I do want to ask you if you've had any signs from your mother since she passed.
I've had dreams.
Mm.
From my father, too.
Mm.
Well, hopefully, yes, her suffering is done. She's in a better place. And yeah, my condolences.
I hope so, because my mother taught me the most important thing about me is I don't get angry. If I get angry, it is so unusual. I mean, I can't say I never get angry, but if I get angry, it is so unusual and it lasts a very short period of time. My mother, I remember when I was in California, we lived way out in the East County. So there was a long highway. Every time I passed her on the road, she was smiling every single time. And that was her outlook on life. And I thought, man, you're not going to do much better than that.
Yes.
If, you know, your karma or whatever may be driving it. I don't think I ever saw my mother angry until she had dementia, but that was basically confusion. But in her waking life, I never saw her get angry. And that's what she taught me. And my father taught me how to think.
Yeah, I love that when you're driving and you look over and you see somebody that's completely by themselves or walking down the street and they're laughing and they're smiling and it's like they're not even trying to, there's nothing fake about it. They're just genuinely radiating joy. And that's, I don't know, I really love that.
Mind precedes all, right? So yes. They're actually, they're injecting into this reality that joy just by having it. Everybody knows the person. You've known a person when they get near you, you just feel better. You just want to be with them. You want to talk, hang out. You want to hug them. Everyone's met that person. Well, what's doing it? Is it a higher vibration? Would that be a way to describe it? Or is it just that they're compassionate and we're living in a world that needs compassion almost as much as it needs oxygen?
Absolutely. I think compassion is a higher vibration.
We need to get back to it.
Absolutely.
Because it's hell-bent world without it.
I wholeheartedly agree. And that might be a good place to draw this to a close and end it on a very positive note. Crow, thank you so much for sitting down and giving us your time and chatting with us. It was highly enjoyable and enlightening. And where can people find you and your work online?
So at this point, no social media is carrying my work. All my work is at crow777radio.com. It's a private server. This is how we protect free speech without being censored. The web address is crrow777radio. Basically, the word crow has two R's, which is a play on my birth name or my slave name, mm-hmm. crow777radio.com. All membership at this point gets free access to Shoot the Moon, which is a 2-hour film Jason made of all the work that I did with telescopes and cameras. Other than that, if you see stuff on social media, it's either me saying, look, there's something on the website, or it's someone copying me.
Mm. Gotcha.
Well, I would definitely say that you are one of those high frequency people that we want to be around and we want to hug. So we're sending you a hug from Kansas.
I'm hoping that by the time they're trying to stuff something in a machine, that my vibration will be high enough to break the damn machine. That's
yes,
my goal.
Exactly. Exactly. Amen. Crow, have a wonderful rest of your day. Thank you for making time out of your usual schedule to do this on the auspicious day of 9/11. And let's talk further on down the line.
All right. Thank you guys so much for having me.
Absolutely.
Best wishes.
Our pleasure.
Thank you.
Take care. Hello, my dear.
Hello, my love.
That was a fantastic conversation, especially in the context of us or me setting my alarm clock an hour later than I should. And by the luck of the draw, you happen to wake up less than an hour before the interview and gently wake me up going, hey, we need to get up and do this. So we were both kind of sleepy-headed, but I thought it went swimmingly. It's a great conversation.
It was. I could talk to you and Crow for many, many hours. It's very enlightening and interesting, and he always has so much to share and does it in such a clear and cohesive way that it really engages my thoughts and my energy, and I really, really enjoyed speaking with him.
Yeah, that's one of the things I like about the show too, is that what was something that we mentioned in the conversation, that there is definitely a plot arc. There's, you know, our show kind of hops around. There's probably a few plot arcs in our show, but some of them are contradictory and you know, don't necessarily fit in seamlessly together. And that's fine for what we do. I think we're trying to give people bits and pieces of not one holistic experience of living in life in this reality, but different people's views and experiences of this reality. And some of them, you know, don't again fit together seamlessly. But what Crow is doing on the Crow and Jason are doing on the podcast is sort of putting pieces together like a big mosaic. Not that that will actually. What are you fiddling around with Zoom for? It's distracting.
Sorry.
That's okay. Putting together a big mosaic, heading in a particular direction. And again, it's not clear cut. It's not like there's a stopping point or an end point, but it's movement and it's forward movement. And I really appreciate that. It's put together in a very cohesive way.
Well, we're not trying to convince anyone of anything or indoctrinate anyone in any way. And I think that Crow is doing the same thing. I think he is presenting information and he's giving his perspective that bleeds in there, but it's not in this, like, I don't feel like I'm being preached to. No. When I listen to his show.
Not at all.
I really enjoy the guests that he has, and that it does seem thematic, and it does seem like there's a through line through all of his shows, where our shows are more like jazz. They're eclectic, and we're kind of hitting all these different notes. And from my perspective, that's really just because we're very curious people. Yeah. And so prior to me being the co-host, I think you had this very, you know, dynamic way of approaching the show. And there's been a real pivot and a real shift of reality. And so we've kind of headed in a very specific way. But we are kind of going back into the non-consensus reality, and not really focusing on like the political agenda or the social engineering agenda. We're bringing other elements into it, and it's exciting.
Mm-hmm. More consciousness-based and sort of cognitive libertarianism, sort of self-governing, and with that, being able to pick and choose what you take from any given episode. We just had Tony Rodriguez on, it'll be a few episodes ago by the time that this comes out, who claims to have experiences in the 20-year and back program. We will have somebody on in the future, and whose name escapes me, Sean Sador, I believe is his name, who claims to be be in a family that's from the line of the Illuminati, excuse me, who thinks that the 20-year and back program is a psyop. It's a memory experiment. They're implanting memories in you that don't exist. So those two things don't jive together. We have Chris Knowles on, who doesn't really believe in AI and thinks advanced technology is a load of hooey. You get people who don't think that way. So it's more like presenting things for you to pick and choose. We're just collecting ideas and experiences and conversations with people who have gone through a wide variety of things. But I don't think we stick on any. I mean, I'm sure there are some unassailable truths that we touch upon, but there's a lot of variables around that, I believe.
Well, in those examples, all of those things could be true.
Yeah, for sure. And like many quantum theory experiments will tell you, is that many people can witness the same event but have a completely different perception of it. And they, in a quantum reality, all of them could be right. So who knows what the nature of reality is? You get people who experience alien abduction experiences, and they're very negative, and they call upon the name of Jesus Christ, and they stop. Then you get people who experience the same thing. They call upon the name of Jesus Christ and nothing happens whatsoever. So there's a lot of different things going on, and who knows how subjective the nature of reality and perception is. We might all be, our realities might all be different, but overlapping enough to have a sort of cohesive field of interaction for us to not totally just be floating in our own soup and not be able to have any kind of contact with the other.
I perceive that reality is what we need it to be. And so for the lessons that we need to learn, if we need it to be a negative experience in order to propel us into action, then those are the things that we're going to pick out. If we need it to be a positive experience to propel us into action or propel us into lessons, excuse me, then those are the things that we're going to pick out. I think that's kind of the basis of what our what the body is giving us and what our mind, the connection we have with our mind is, you know, what is the most efficacious way for you to learn as an individual. And that's why you gel with some people and you have a negative reaction when you are around someone else, because maybe the lessons that you need to learn from that people, you're not, or that person, you're not ready to learn in the moment.
Well, and we're just using you and I as an example. You might go to a person and for some reason it may not seem that they are of like mind about a particular topic, but you might just bring it up anyway and go into detail about it and engage them in a discussion and actually get to a place where there is some overlap and that you reach some sort of place where there is a connection. And I might perceive that same person as not being like-minded for whatever reason. Doesn't mean that it's rooted in reality at all, and withhold that conversation and no connection happens. So just even using us two as an example, that's how differently we can all navigate reality and how we can affect reality by what we bring to it. Just go out and start screaming at everybody and see what reaction you get, and go out and, you know, look people in the eyes and address them as equals and go out of your way to, you know, wish them a good day and see what kind of reaction you get. Those are different things. And you had everything to do with that.
Exactly. I think we're here to learn and grow. And that's one of the questions that you had for Crow that I think we, on some level, we already have the answer to. It's interesting to hear what his answer would be. But one of the questions was, perhaps this is an experiment. Mm-hmm. And I think this is an experiment. And every day and every second of every day, we have a decision to make of how we are, and Crow talked about that, of how we are perceiving that experiment and what we're doing with it. Are we looking for the darkness, or are we looking for a lighter energy? And mm-hmm. what, therefore, are we bringing to it? Are we bringing lightness? Are we bringing darkness? One thing that you and I both have is a amazing sense of curiosity. We're curious about the world. We're curious about people. We're curious about systems and how they work and how we interact with them. And I don't think either one of us is stuck in any one ideology. We haven't co-signed on something and said this is what it is and there's nothing else. I think from a very basic level we agree on the natural world, but then there's so much more in this experiment that we're perceiving and that we're understanding that the jury is still out on.
I wonder why we're curious.
We're thought curious.
You see what I did there?
I did.
Okay. Of course you did. Even though we're sleepy. Yes. And, you know, it's a part of reality shifting is being an active participant, which you're excellent at, and not being a passive participant. Some people might stumble upon somebody that seems to be in a grumpy mood and go, think to themselves, oh, they're grumpy. I'm just going to kind of, you know, give them a wide berth. Somebody like you might engage that person even more and try to interact with them on a higher frequency. And maybe even shift their frequency to a higher, not forcefully, of course, but just by being in proximity to a higher frequency, transforming that, transmuting that to a higher frequency.
Well, we had last evening, we had our wedding reception, and we had a group of about 35 people in our home, and it was so beautiful to see people, some like-minded, some divergent in their perceptions, all being able to commune and be together in the same space. And I think that's such a valuable microcosm of what the world that we live in is, and what, and the ability that we have in this world. Because it's so easy to get myopic and think, well, I just want to be around people I agree with, because that's easy. It's easy for us just to kind of stay in the same echo chamber. But what that party proved to me and just reinforced is you can get people together who don't necessarily agree on every aspect of reality, whether it be political or healthcare or, you know, just basic philosophy. You can get those people together and they can speak to each other respectfully. They can enjoy each other's company and they don't necessarily have to agree. So I want more of that in our lives.
Especially in this context that we find ourselves in now, where the divide and conquer is being pushed like it never has been before. It's sort of like it's just been set in motion by the parasitical elites. And then people have just taken it up upon themselves to push that agenda in their own self-effacing way. Not self-effacing, that's not the word I'm looking for. In their own brand, in their own way, to divide people by the simplistic and ridiculous concept of political parties, mask wearers, not mask wearers, vaxxers, not vaxxers, blah, 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 on and on and on. I'm sure we don't need to go into details because you have your own versions of that in your life, which regardless of whatever quote unquote side you're on, sides, that there are sides, that we think that they're sides. That's the ultimate psyop right there, thinking that we are divided at all. It's fucking ridiculous.
Yeah, but these people aren't elite. They're predators. They're absolute predators. And let's just, for my wordage and my dialect, I'm not going to give them the deference to say that they're elite. What I see is these are fear-based, low-frequency parasites, as you said. Yeah. And what they're trying to do is control something that in their perception is controllable, which is humanity, but in reality isn't controllable. We don't have to go along with the agenda.
And that's the sad part, is that many people, well, they don't hope that they don't see it in this clear-cut way, believe they are controllable by acquiescing to whatever narrative that they're given without thinking really about what the source is. Do we have one reason to trust any corporation, first and foremost, but especially one like Big Pharma, who has a horrible, horrendous track record, paying out billions and billions of dollars in lawsuits just to shut people up for their fuck-ups. Yeah. Politics, come on, people. When are we going to get over this one? Like, to believe in any politician, bar maybe your local, a few local politicians, since when do we trust politics? Since when do we trust politicians? I mean, it's easy because, you know, we have this stupid, simplistic, dualistic two-party system that makes it easy for somebody who's on one side to go, well, you can't trust the other side. Yeah. But you can't trust any side, really.
I just wonder, you know, do we really need social media? Do we really need to live in this very individualistic society that we've created that has done very little other than separate us? And I think sometimes if everyone stopped driving for a year, if everyone stopped participating in this consensus reality that we exist in, what would really happen? Like, how would these systems fail? Mm-hmm. Because I think that's what these predators rely on, is that we have this relationship that is necessitates our engagement with it. And I think if we stopped it, then they would completely lose the hold and the control that they have over a good percentage of the population. If people stopped watching Fox News, if they stopped watching MSNBC, if they cut themselves off from the media completely, what kind of an environment would we be in?
Yeah. I mean, I think in many ways we may or may not realize we hold it all up.
Exactly.
It's just a house of cards, really. I mean, as Max Egan has said and says often, you know, we could change the world in 3 seconds. Really, if we just all changed our minds, that's all this is, as a manifestation of mind. It's easy to mistake it for something that has inherent meaning in and of itself, and it's this concrete thing, but it isn't. We have concrete buildings, we have concrete institutions, but those things are inhabited by people with minds who can change, and right. There's no same shit, different day. We make it. Make it all up.
But are those things static? That's the thing that we have to really understand, is that we're perceiving things as being solid and having some solid form, but do they really, or is it just that we all agree on that?
That's exactly what it is. It's just an agreement. Consensus reality is just that. It's a reality that the consensus agrees on, or at least we're led to believe that the consensus agrees on it.
Right. And I think that's why you can go into these environments where there are tribes that have had no contact with quote unquote modern man, and they don't have the same diseases. They don't have the same fears and worries and anxieties, because those things haven't been implanted.
Yep. Exactly. That's as I've mentioned before too, and maybe you even have, like the comic frame. It's not a strip. What is it if it's one frame? What is it called?
Cell.
Maybe. Comic Cell. Who's got like a news reporter talking to an Amish guy. Like, how has COVID affected the Amish community? And he says, not at all. Why? Because we don't have TV. Like, it's as simple as that. Exactly. How many of these are mind contagions that we experience? Like, they're just ideas, memes. That's what meme used to mean, that were put out into the world and then just go haywire because we're so used to wondering what we're going to fear next, because it's around every corner, we're told, that we're just so paranoid and hyper aware of the next thing to freak out on that we would just grasp onto it.
It's wild. It's wild. It's wild. It's wild and wacky stuff.
It's a crazy old world we live in.
And I love it.
I do too. I wouldn't have it any, well, I'm sure I would have it any other way. But, you know, sometimes you just got to step in some mud puddles to know that you probably might want to walk around them. Or you might want to take your shoes off and step through them barefooted. I don't know.
Yeah. I think we're here at this perfect time, in this perfect body, in this perfect world, to understand the imperfections and to be able to redream it in the way that is most efficient for it to exist. And we just need to step out of nature's way and allow things to be as they truly are, as opposed to trying to control them.
Exactly. We don't have to look under every rock to figure out everything about the world. The world will tell us what it is. We just have to get out of the way and watch it. And sometimes it takes time.
Yeah, I think that's why people turn to television and the media, is because there's a certain level of laziness in the human experience that says, just tell me what to think, just tell me what to believe, just tell me what to feel, when it's so much more, the human experience is so much richer if you actually just perceive, if you just feel.
I think you use the word right there, experience. Watching TV media passively is not an experience. So many people have gotten so used to seeing the world and the universe, or however you want to look at it, this realm through that window, that they don't experience it anymore. So they go by other people's experiences and trust them and denote them experts of certain realms of experience. And yeah. Then we stop experiencing, and then we stop trusting our own experiences. Yeah. Hey, you can't trust firsthand experience. Like, really? How did we get here? Like,
I knew I was watching too much TV when I was in my early 20s and I was a nanny, and I turned to a friend of mine and I said, Oprah told me ... Uh-huh. Because in the day I would be watching Oprah when the baby was asleep, and it really felt like Oprah was communicating with me.
Interesting. Strange. Strange life.
Strange weirdness.
Yes. We've gone on for quite a while.
I know.
Perhaps
I dig it.
We should draw to a close, which I kind of make up for the fact that we didn't have a 2-hour interview. Thank you all so much for listening and getting this far. And hopefully you were able to glean something positive. I don't know how you couldn't, unless you're a total fuddy-duddy and you just don't understand where we're coming from at all, which in that case I don't know why you're listening to us. Maybe just because you're curious.
But it's okay. Yeah. If you didn't get anything,
sure.
Maybe on a subconscious level you are hearing the vibration of our voices and something is coming across. You're perceiving our energy and the love that we feel for each other and the love we feel for this earth.
Yeah, food for thought. Even if that thought is, these people are full of shit. That's something right
hey,
there.
I'm yeah. okay with it.
Thank you for being open enough to even take it all in, regardless of what you think about it. Yay you for being open-minded. As I say, open-minded is even better than like-minded. You don't have to be like-minded. We don't all have to be on the same page, but we should be open to other pages. So on that note, if you have guest suggestions,
recipe ideas,
life hacks, I can't think of anything clever, so I'm not going to try and make up something.
Vacation spots.
I was going to say something like that, but I couldn't think of a funny way of wording it. You can contact us at themeltpodcast@protonmail.com or
hunter-muse@protonmail.com.
Yes. And there will be in the episode notes ways to go to our various media outlets. And really, most of the time, that's besides the Discord channel, it's just advertising our episodes.
Yeah, we share stuff on there, but fairly infrequently, because I'm in school now, so I was kind of putting a lot of social media energy out there, and then I realized, ooh, look, something shiny, and I got distracted.
Squirrel? Yes, I used to meme assault people on Instagram, and then, you know, I don't know what I got off of that. Got off of Instagram, decided to get back on just as a place to advertise the episodes. Yeah. So if you want the meme assault, you can choose to do so by going on the Discord channel. There's a whole meme area you can go to and feast and pass on and whatever.
Yeah, it's
anyway,
fun.
Yeah, it's good. It's a good time.
Yeah.
I suggest it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Love you guys.
We love you. Take care and just stay tuned. There's lots of fantastic stuff coming.
All right. Bye.
Goodbye. If you've liked what you've heard and would like to contribute to The Melt, there are a few ways that you can do that. The most tangible would be financially. Just click the Patreon link in the episode notes, and there you will find ways that you can contribute for as little as $3 a month. This will give you access to bonus episodes, early access to regular episodes, and you can also participate in monthly Zoom meetups.
Contributing financially will also help make the melt better, pay the bills, and help to make this podcast a full-time endeavor that I can fully devote my time to and provide you with more content. Another way of contributing would be to go to wherever it is that you subscribe to The Melt and give it a favorable review or rating, and this will help it to reach more people. You can also spread the word to friends and family via social media, email, or word of mouth. And lastly, if none of those options are readily available or appealing to you, simply send your positive thoughts and intentions. In an interconnected and quantumly entangled multiverse, these also go a long way. Thank you.